The Sons and Daughters Podcast. Discover and walk in the life that Jesus lives inside of you. Hosted by Andy and Tina Hainer, leaders of Full Speed Impact Ministry.
2, 1, love.
Hi. Welcome to the Sons and Daughters Podcast. I'm Tina Hainer, and this is my husband, Andy Hainer.
And we are leaders of the Full Speed Impact Ministries. We are dedicated to equip and mobilize believers to walk in the fullness of Jesus Christ and impact the world around you. And that's exactly what happens when you let Jesus fill you and transform you. You begin to, as you abide in him, you will bear much fruit.
Mm-hmm.
And he will manifest himself to the world through you. And that's what he plans to do. So we want to encourage you. So last time we talked about freedom in Christ.
Yes.
Particularly, spent a lot of time focusing on legalism. And mm-hmm. I just felt like before we move on, I wanted to emphasize something because freedom doesn't just come because you avoid legalism.
Sure.
Freedom mm-hmm. in Christ really is the freedom of Christ
right.
lived in us.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not constrained by anything except his love for the Father, his nature. It's his nature to do what the Father loves. And so one of the things that came to mind, I wish I would have said last week, but we're going to get it in here, was how Moses, when he went to the Pharaoh, his message from God was not simply to let God's people go, but to let them go that they might serve me,
mm-hmm.
that they may worship me.
Mm-hmm.
And so our freedom is not just from things like freedom from sin,
freedom from
guilt,
bondage,
shame.
And darkness. Mm-hmm.
That's good. But the only yeah. way that we're going to really walk in that freedom and to maintain that is by entering in to a lifestyle of devoting ourselves to God. If we're not doing that, we're not going to experience freedom, and something else is going to take God's
place,
and
sure.
that brings us into bondage.
Mm-hmm,
and so yeah. it's really kind of apropos, a good place to start today's discussion, because
sure.
we're going to talk about the power of kingdom generosity, genuine generosity.
Generosity yeah.
If you've been around church or Christianity at all, it can be kind of a sensitive subject sometimes.
Sure, about passing the offering plate
because,
and giving to building programs.
Yeah.
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, because there's often been, it's come from a place of pressure,
right.
obligation,
mm-hmm.
guilt
you should.
Trips.
Mm-hmm.
But then on the other hand, there's been a reaction against that pastors, and a lot of times people in ministry feel they don't want to get thrown into that category.
Sure.
So they never teach on it, never talk about it at all,
mm-hmm.
Because they're afraid that people are going to be thinking that, hey, you know,
you
he's
just
want
me
teaching
to.
This because mm-hmm. you want my money.
Right.
Well, this podcast is going to be real interesting because we don't
need
your money.
Money.
We don't want your money. You know,
right.
if you want to bless our ministry, that's one
great.
Thing.
Yeah.
But this is really to build you up so that you can experience the freedom of a generous lifestyle.
Right. And the blessing, the
yes.
abundant blessing, right.
Because mm-hmm. it seems like a mindset of generosity really is built on the foundation of a strong revelation, a confidence in the goodness
of God.
God,
right. And his character, you know, I mean, you cannot describe God's character without thinking, seeing generosity.
Amen.
Overwhelming generosity.
Yeah, I mean, if you've ever been out to an apple orchard, just getting to be about fall,
yep.
and it's,
mm-hmm.
you know, apple orchard time, it's like every tree has enough apples to supply a neighborhood,
sure.
you know,
mm-hmm.
for months.
Mm-hmm.
We get,
mm-hmm.
you know, you get apples, and you get applesauce, and apple pie, and apple fritters, and apple, you know,
mm-hmm. apples.
Just everything. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's really a picture of the abundance of Christ.
Right, right. And I think that whole idea of kingdom generosity is really not giving it all out of compulsion, obligation, but really that enjoying how good and abundant your Father in heaven is.
Exactly.
And that, hey, my daddy's got plenty. So, mm-hmm. you know, I'm not going to be in lack because I give to you, and that I have a freedom to give abundantly.
Yeah. You know, if there's a lot of people who they know that they ought to, they admire generosity. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But we want to really talk about what are the things that unlock our hearts so that we can live a generous lifestyle, not just trying to figure out what's the biblical minimum that I sure. have to give.
9.9%.
Yeah. Oh, you know, if you didn't, is it before or after taxes? All this kind right. of stuff that Christians think of because they're trying to find out the rules. And it's mm-hmm. great to follow up a generous, you know, have a podcast on generosity and a generous lifestyle after discovering freedom in Christ and freedom from legalism. Because really, the neat thing about it is you're free to receive from God, receive His abundant grace, realize how much He's given to mm-hmm. you, how much He's paid for you,
provide.
How mm-hmm. sure and faithful are His promises to mm-hmm. provide, to care, mm-hmm. and let your heart soak in that. And it will, if we didn't say anything, you would want to give.
Right.
But once you come to that place, it's neat to really equip your understanding because as time goes on and different situations arise in our life, you know, we get tested mm-hmm. In our faith sometimes, but it's really nice just to have that momentum of generosity that comes from God, hits our hearts, fills us, mm-hmm. and then just overflows.
And you know it's supernatural. Yeah, because our tendencies necessarily wouldn't be that way. I was just thinking about how we live in a society that highly, highly values efficiency and you know, squeezing the goodie out of everything you know, having even manufacturing, lean manufacturing, the most profit and that kind of thing. And mm-hmm. And that's okay. There's some value. There really is some good value to that. But when that takes the forefront, it can kind of squeeze out just that freedom and creativity and that the overflow and the flowing of love.
Yeah.
And giving out of that, it comes from a different place.
Yeah. You know, when Jesus said that if you seek first the kingdom and His righteousness, that everything mm-hmm. else will be supplied abundantly mm-hmm. to us, you. Will be given to you. If you look at that, you realize, you know, along with the kingdom, you seek first the kingdom. Well, the kingdom is where? It's within you.
Mm-hmm.
And so as God sets up His order, it unlocks us creativity and opportunity. And so it's really important because if you're not seeking to live in kingdom generosity, you are being limited by a fleshly mindset of poverty,
right.
of mm-hmm. lack. And so there's opportunities to bless others, opportunities to take risks that are right. going to move your business
growing
or your family mm-hmm.
growing your faith, right.
And so it's really, that's just amazing, that confidence God will provide.
Mm-hmm.
If I seek mm-hmm. first the kingdom and His righteousness, just that basic level of He's going to provide for me.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But it's not, He doesn't just leave it there.
Mm-mm.
So what do you think of when you think of kingdom generosity or genuine generosity or some things that come to mind for you mm-hmm. that you feel like would encourage others?
Yeah, yeah. There's several scriptures. One is in the New Testament of when the woman comes in, Jesus is eating with Pharisees again and just His disciples, and a woman comes in and she has a flask, an alabaster jar of a costly nard,
yeah.
and she spends it on Him. She wastes it, so to speak. She lavishes it on Him, and Jesus says she does a beautiful thing. And
I think the disciples, they were grumbling.
They were, and it was like, this could have been used to feed the poor. There's that efficiency, right. and we, you know, a better use for it. And Jesus said, well, you've always got the poor with you. She's doing this now to honor me, to prepare me for burial. And And Jesus saw it for what it was from her heart, a generous gift. And I'm sure to her, he said that she did it because she's been forgiven much. And, right. and you know, and for her, it probably didn't feel like a big, expensive gift of being generous to the Lord. It felt like, oh, my goodness, I can't help myself but to worship him.
I mean, honestly, she probably was like, this is the King of the universe who has touched me,
forgiven
set
me
free, mm-hmm. forgiven me, and I've got hardly anything. The only thing I've got is this bottle of perfume that has been passed down probably from generations. Some people say that it was probably used as part of her profession as a prostitute, right? Because they would try to make themselves smell good. And, you know, it was the marketing campaign. And I mean, nobody wants to spend any time with a stinky woman, but now she, now, no offense, stinky women out there.
Yeah.
I'm sure we don't have any of those listening to our podcast. Only beautiful woman. Anyway, but she's, you know, basically, I'm not going to need this anymore. But what's funny is that Jesus really, he looked right at her motives.
Absolutely.
How many times have you been talked out of doing something generous because your practical brain starts kicking in and saying,
questioning,
you know, well, you could give it to this person, but, you know, they're probably going to do this or they won't appreciate
it.
This. Mm-hmm. But if you do it, and that's the whole neat thing about it, is kingdom generosity is directed and motivated with a love for Jesus.
Absolutely. Even if you're giving to somebody else, it's to him and for him. Because whatever you do to the least of these, my brethren, you've done to me.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. There's another scripture that I was just reading recently about. I'm reading about King David, and he calls for a census, and
brought
that
a plague on the land.
Yeah, there was something he was supposed to do, and it brought a plague on the land. Yeah, and it comes to a breaking point, and the Lord moves him to go to this certain person's house where the plague was about to hit, and basically make an offering, an offering. And he goes to approach the man and says, I want to buy your threshing floor to do all these offerings. And the man's like, oh, awesome king, great king, I'll just give it to you. Because, you know, he loved this king, he loved the Lord. And David, he makes this comment of, I will not sacrifice to the Lord that which costs me nothing. And again, there's that, you know, it's a sacrifice to the Lord. Sometimes our generosity, it may hurt a little, you know, on a practical level. Like, it's like, ooh, that's a big chunk. But and that can be monetarily, it can be of time, it can be of energy, of giving. But is it really a sacrifice if it doesn't cost us something? Is it really giving?
You know,
if there's not some cost to us.
I want to share, this reminds me of just some stories that, you know, one of the neat things about it is if you've been in the kingdom any amount of time, you get to see this happen, not just begin to understand it.
There's testimonies, absolutely.
When you talked about that, I remember one Sunday during worship, one of the young kids in the front row just started bawling during, you know, crying profusely during worship. And then I saw their parent, you know, reach over and they were comforting them. And I went and asked the parent later, you know, what was happening? You know, was the Holy Spirit really touching them? And they said, well, sort of, because this child had saved up a lot of money and wanted to, was saving for, you know,
something
like that. And, but God had told her to give it, and she did, but now she's regretting it.
She's like, I can't give this.
But then she came around to the other side of being happy once again. It was just going through that doubt. And what's amazing is, and we've experienced this even with our own kids.
Sure.
You know, of trying to encourage them that we give, one, so that our it's a regular reminder to our hearts that money doesn't own us.
Right.
That money is not our God.
We're in charge of telling it where to go.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And that our money doesn't provide for us our security. Our jobs mm-hmm. don't supply to us our security. Our security, our confidence is in God Almighty mm-hmm. as our provider, mm-hmm. as our caregiver. Mm-hmm. And so we regularly, you know, from our income, from the first fruits of our labor, we want to give. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so one of the things that one story besides that I really like, I'm friends with some pretty amazing people. Mm-hmm. And one of my pastor friends in India, their family went through an amazing tragedy that God actually just did this amazing mm-hmm. thing. Their mm-hmm. house exploded in an amazing gas fire. It's basically like a row, you know, everything is kind of concrete and the news came and it looked like a bomb blast.
Yeah.
There was concrete that had flown everywhere. Mm-hmm. Pastor Danny suffered major burns, was miraculously healed by an angelic visit. Mm-hmm. There's a book out by it that I actually helped ghostwrite for him called Through the Fire. It's by Pastor Mecca Danny from India. So it's on Amazon. It's called Through the Fire. Mm-hmm. And it's really
a great,
really
testimony of God's healing and faithfulness.
But
yeah.
One of the things that was amazing is that as God was restoring to them and providing for them to rebuild their house, mm-hmm. that explosion was so bad that parts of their apartment mm-hmm. concrete went flying through the roof mm-hmm. and the sides and the walls and the gates of their neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
And that neighborhood was primarily Hindu and Muslim, primarily Hindu, but on the other side was Muslim. And they were very, they would tolerate Danny, but were very standoffish. What he did was amazing is mm-hmm. that as he got the money in, he actually paid for his neighbors' houses
repairs.
And gates, all those repairs to be done first mm-hmm. before he started the first repair on mm-hmm. his own house.
Mm-hmm.
And that spoke so his family, mm-hmm. his neighbors, that they began sending their children for the first time to the church children's programs. They began visiting mm-hmm. And many of them came to know the Lord. As a result of this, and
nothing but generosity, the Lord prompting him and generously taking care of his neighbors that way. I mean,
right.
That's what opened the door.
Right.
Absolutely. In a horrible, tragic situation, God just totally turned it around.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, one of my favorite verses regarding finances, regarding a lot of things, one of my favorite verses altogether says in 2 Corinthians 9:8 says, and mm-hmm. God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
And, you know, like, especially as a man, as a provider for the family, or, you know, somebody who's wearing the pressure of wanting to provide for your loved ones, mm-hmm. You know, if you run into trouble at work, you start having these crazy thoughts of what's going to happen to my family, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, mm-hmm. single moms, you know, it's not just men. I don't want to be certain.
It's the providers.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes you put all this performance pressure on yourself because they do at work, but it's nice to step back into that, because what if I didn't do it right, blah, blah, blah. God's able to make all grace abound to you,
mm-hmm.
so that having
all sufficiency
mm-hmm. in all things at all times,
mm-hmm.
you may abound in everything good work.
Right.
So the challenge with that is that every good work doesn't stop at our driveway.
Mm-hmm.
It really needs to flow out beyond our family, mm-hmm. out into the communities, into the friendships, into the neighborhoods and communities
mm-hmm.
that we live in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think that verse is neat too, because in all things at all times, you know, it's like in all things. So it's not just financially,
mm-hmm.
you know, there's a sufficiency that we find in God in emotionally,
yes.
strength and energy and stewarding our time and all those things in all things.
The reason it can be such a challenge to be generous, I think sometimes is because we're only dealing with what's on our ledger sheet.
Sure.
And we think of income mainly in terms of what we can provide for ourselves, mm-hmm. but God's resources are just amazing.
Right. We can't fathom. We cannot fathom.
We have a friend who's been a partner of our ministry, and we visited them in Montana. This was a couple of years back,
mm-hmm.
and he was sharing with us how God had just been revolutionizing their family as they understood kingdom finances more and more.
Mm-hmm.
And not only him, but his family was learning this, and he shared how his daughter, one of his older daughters, was getting ready to graduate and was believing God for a car. And she had been working, and she had been learning that she can give, but to give in faith, believing God for provision, because that's one of the ways that the kingdom works. You seek first the kingdom, you know.
And there's faith involved.
Paul talks about that. He calls giving seeds to the sower, that mm-hmm. actually mm-hmm. as we give, that sometimes we're giving into the kingdom, but we're planting those as seeds for a harvest, for a return. And mm-hmm. you know, that there can be this mindset of, you know, I give only to get.
To get, no.
And that's yeah. not what the kingdom is, but you give because you're free.
Right.
And yeah. you have confidence that God is able to provide, not mm-hmm. your hoarding, not mm-hmm. your selfishness,
not your good planning.
not that there's not a place for all
sure.
of that. But, you know, it wasn't, you know, there's some people that just work their fingers to the bone. They work mm-hmm. them, you know, they work themselves out of having any relationship with their spouse or with their friends or anything. She wasn't doing that. She was working and she was giving and she was believing for mm-hmm. a provision that was beyond her. Here's the crazy thing. This is where it gets neat to
radical.
Me.
Radical. Yeah.
Is at that same time, she had another friend that was also in need of a car. And God spoke to her heart when she got all the money ready to go out and buy a car. As she was car hunting, God said, this car is for your friend. And she bought her, with that money that she had received, she bought her friend that car.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a short time later that at a very accelerated rate, the full finances came in for her to get her a car again.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just neat to watch that
yes.
because her dad is standing back, you know, sharing the story
yes.
with me. It's like, you know, I'm learning kingdom finances. I'm teaching it to my family, but I'm trying to catch up with my yeah, kids yeah. here.
Sure. Sure.
And they were the family that had given us
right
an RV.
Mm-hmm, right.
We had done some training in their area, and God spoke to their heart and said, you know, that
the Hairs could use your RV.
Yeah, which was crazy.
Yeah,
so it was just
and a blessing for the time that we had it. Absolutely.
It was. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I was thinking too how you cannot outgive God. And again, it's that mentality of I have a good father, an abundant father. And just recently, our daughter, she'd agreed to babysit for a friend who, single mom and working and running around, and had agreed to pay her, cause it was just a few days
yeah.
and they had agreed on a price. And so, Phoebe was gonna watch her baby. And then the day before or whatever, she had major car trouble, like breakdown car, like trouble, like it's not coming back.
The single mom, not
the
Phoebe.
Single mom, yeah. not Phoebe. Yeah. And so Phoebe's heart just went out to her. And more than that, God spoke to her and said, why don't you watch her baby for free?
Yeah.
Just take care of her. She could really use a break.
Yeah.
And so she did. And again, Phoebe was saving up for something in particular. Yeah. But she knew she wanted to do this. But it was interesting because just like our little friend at church, like it was with tears, but mm-hmm. like, I know this is good. I feel good doing this. As it turned out later, a family member blessed Phoebe
yes.
with more than what our other friend who had the baby could have paid her.
And it was interesting that when that happened.
Yeah, you want
to. God spoke to her heart mm-hmm. and said, "This is your payment for babysitting." It was God mm-hmm. was telling her, "Look, I'll pay you.
Right. You did it for me.
Yeah.
And I'm taking care of her." And that's what I mean by, you know, sometimes giving isn't monetarily, like it's not us sending a check sometimes
right.
or handing out cash. It's a lot of times there's that, and it can be a painful sacrifice.
Right.
It's our time and our energy.
Well, what's neat mm-hmm. too is like if you're working and at a job, you're providing for your own income. Sometimes people tend not to always see that as ministry. But, you know, Paul says that if somebody's been stealing, she should steal no longer and work with his own hands
so that
he might provide for his own needs mm-hmm. and have something to give. And so it's really neat because, you know, somebody who's stealing is actually taking stuff from other people.
Sure.
They're living as a taker.
Mm-hmm.
But in the kingdom mindset, listen, if you have a job you're not real excited about, the work doesn't motivate you. One of the things I tell people over and over is you've got to connect your work with what does motivate
mm-hmm.
you. You know, Paul would tell this, he said, "Slaves, work as unto the Lord with all your heart, knowing that from him you get your reward."
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. and so that's, we've got to connect that. And so one of the things that it's encouraging is that this is a ministry, is that I'm providing for my family, taking care of my own needs, mm-hmm. and I'm also
getting to give
to others.
Part.
This
mm-hmm.
is equipping, putting more mm-hmm. seeds in our mm-hmm. bucket so that mm-hmm. we can sow them into other people's lives.
Yeah, and it's a very real and tangible expression of God. I mean, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son.
Mm-hmm.
And as we give, I mean, maybe it's not giving our only son, but it's a bit of a picture at places in people's lives how generous our God is, how gracious he is.
Yeah. And it's, you know, one of the things that I've always seen in kingdom giving that's really important to remember is that when you're giving, if you're giving primarily just to the church, it's important that you do that as unto the Lord
mm-hmm.
and not do that in a way that is some sort of leverage and power in
mm-hmm.
that community
mm-hmm.
to try to manipulate the board or the programs or the pastor. That's
or
just,
I get some more say because I gave more. Mm-hmm.
When you give, you don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. And I
mm-hmm.
believe that Jesus intends for us basically in the body that you're giving is not something that's, you know, trying to leverage or control something over
mm-hmm.
somebody else. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, I just read a Facebook post the other day of a guy who said, "Well, we decided to leave our church because our pastor called me into his office because he was a little upset that I refused to use the offering envelopes." And he had a personal conviction, this person, I mean, we use offering envelopes, we're no big deal. But he felt like he wanted his giving to be in cash completely between him and
my
the
God.
Lord.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was no bit in, you know, and the pastor, you know, was trying to use terms like, "Well, we like to keep track of this in case you have, you know, have needs of some support and that kind of thing." And,
right.
you know, the guy kind of saw through. It's like, "No, you want to know exactly
track
what I'm
my
giving.
Giving.
Track, you know, you know, that kind
mm-hmm.
of stuff."
Mm-hmm.
And we got to be really careful mm-hmm. with that, not read motives in, you know, because there's different ways of organizing things.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really important that we not use giving as some sort of, if you're still trying to use money as if it's your money and you're trying to manipulate and control, that's just wrong.
Mm-hmm.
That's just wrong.
Mm-hmm.
It's when you give, give freely, mm-hmm. let it go.
Yeah. You know, as we were talking, I was thinking about how Paul kind of was an intermediary between the church in Jerusalem, Judea, that was suffering famine, and Gentile churches, mm-hmm. and how they would take an offering and then provide that to the people that were in great need, right. and how, you know, Paul talks about how your generosity to these people in need that you don't even know, you haven't even seen, but we're one, we're brothers and sisters, mm-hmm. in Christ, but you're helping provide for their need. It brings them into you, into their hearts, right. and they love you for it. Yeah. And I was just thinking about how, you know, we receive gifts from people, generous gifts, and
we've been in full-time ministry since for about 7 or 8 years now.
Yeah. And we get those gifts, and how it's so true that when you're on the receiving end of somebody's generosity, it really does open your heart up to that person, and you pray for them, you know? Right. And so you want to bless them. You want to, you know, even if it's not this, well, I need to return the favor. It's not that at all. It's like, I've been blessed, and you know, it's from your Heavenly Father, and He's just using them, but that you want to turn around and you want to pray and intercede and be a blessing to them. And I just think that's a neat dynamic of how that works, you know, in the body.
There's a story in the Old Testament. One of the prophets, Elijah or Elisha, I get their lives confused sometimes, where a woman built a spare room for him, mm-hmm. and she knew she couldn't buy his miracles, right. and that's important, mm-hmm. because there's a lot of manipulation that goes on trying to coerce the body of Christ to give. If anybody is trying to tell you that you need to give money in order to get a miracle that Jesus paid for, that's
false
wrong.
False gospel.
Mm-hmm. But what she did, what this lady did understand, is that her generosity of being willing to provide food and board for the prophet, mm-hmm. would build a relationship.
Right.
And that put her, because of who he was, that put her in a good position to be able to bless her family and to bless him. And so there's this free giving and receiving, mm-hmm. in the body of Christ. It doesn't, you know, one doesn't have the other in the headlock or anything like that. So when we first got started in ministry, we had a number of examples. And, you know, one of the examples that was out there was trying to encourage people to be partners and to give at certain levels and to kind of sign up for that and that sort, mm-hmm. of thing. And we don't, you know, we have people that do partner with us on a regular basis, mm-hmm. but we never asked people to declare
this as a
commitment, mm-hmm. You know, because we felt like we always wanted to look directly to God for provision and not to people. Mm-hmm. And in the same way, you know, when I give, I don't like to give in a way that's somehow coerced out of me. So I think it's really important that it's not only on the giving side, but the receiving side,
sure.
that, you know, you're sort of not manipulating this. Mm-hmm. One of the things I really like is in Hebrews, it says, keep your life free from the love of money.
Yes.
And so one of the ways that I look at generosity is it's a way of declaring my freedom.
I'm free.
Mm-hmm. But he goes on and says, and be content with what you have, for God has said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. So we can, mm-hmm. confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Mm-hmm. So this is the cool thing about it, is that when you're confident that God is present with you, that God is your helper, that he's practically involved in your life, it sets you free to not look to money as your God.
Right.
And now it becomes a tool. And so, mm-hmm. you know, there's a number of different ways that generosity just flows out. But one of those things that really is, like, I love the picture of when Jesus saw that the 5,000, you know, people, the hillsides were just crammed with 5,000 men.
So
there's probably at least 30,000, because you've got women
and children.
You've got children, you know, and so that was crowded. And they had been with him for 3 days, and the disciples are trying to encourage these, you need to send these people home because
they need to go get something to eat.
And Jesus said, you give them something to eat.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's the problem, is that oftentimes we see needs, and we see needs that are so abundant that we don't do anything. And Jesus's answer to those problems is what he can do through us. We've got to put ourselves in position for this. And what's interesting is that the way that the miracle took place is it started with the little that they had. They put it in Jesus's hands after they had organized the people to be able to steward the abundance. And it's really important that we prepare ourselves for kingdom increase by preparing ourselves to steward a kingdom increase. There's a lot of people who are believing God for change and for business growth or for, you know, this or that, but they're just, they are not prepared to steward the growth.
If and when it comes.
And so he had them organize them into groups, and then they took a little bit of, they took what they had and they gave it all to Jesus, and he blessed it, broke it, put it back in their hands. So they went from having something. They put it in Jesus' hands. Now their hands are empty. Now it's in Jesus' hands. They put it, he puts it back in their hands with instructions. This is for them. To now. And so they had to keep going through this. Okay, my hands are full.
And
now I've given out. Now my hands are empty. But I go back to Jesus. And now my hands are full. And so if you want to put yourself in position for kingdom generosity, you've got to prepare yourself to go through that cycle of receiving, giving, being empty-handed, receiving. And so as soon as they, if any one of them would have stopped and just said, okay, this is for me, and sat down and started eating what they had in their hands, they would have ceased to be part of that miracle.
Sure.
And there would have been the flow would have languishing longer. And so it's really important that we keep our lives free from the love of money, because part of what God wants to do through us involves generosity.
Absolutely.
Let's get practical. What are some of the ways, besides, you know, giving to church or to ministries, missions? Those are really good. Those are kind of assumptions. And so even if we don't talk about that too much, what are some of the other ways that you find God prompting you or others around you that you see this, this is what a kingdom generosity, this is what a generous lifestyle looks like.
Well, it, again, you know, there, it very often will mean that we might be a little uncomfortable for a little bit. That it can mean, you know, taking a little extra time with someone. I think a huge thing is discipleship. You know, that's just so much my heartbeat is discipling believers, and so it, but it doesn't come if I'm not willing to give time and prayer for them, and in talking and counsel and preparation. And
so I like this. Your first example is not necessarily just giving money, but a generous lifestyle means giving of yourself, giving time. And you know, I have a scripture verse for this because that God reminded me of, where Peter and John were walking, saw the man begging who was lame, and their first thing was, you know, look at us, and they said, silver and gold we don't have,
but what we do have
we give to you in the name of Jesus, rise and walk. So there was that willingness to take from their time, to stop, to interrupt their day, their plans, and to engage with this person who had obvious needs, and recognizing, listen, all the solutions aren't necessarily the money in your pocket. It's the investment that you can make in other people. Supernatural. Gospel preaching, miracles, healing, signs and wonders.
So, yeah. And I think, just on a real practical level too, within our families, you know, parents with children, brothers and sisters, that, that dynamic of, serving one another, blessing one another, giving of ourselves, to one another, that it, you know, when we are in the comfort of our home, but yet, you know, there's opportunity to be stretched and to grow in And giving of ourselves.
Yeah.
Again, and it's that time of, I wanted to go do this, or I had this idea or whatever, but you know, I'm going to give in this way, give some grace.
I'll give you some examples of ways that our lives have been touched by kingdom generosity.
Mm-hmm.
The cameras that we're recording on,
yes,
were gifts to our ministry, mm-hmm, because somebody
who knew what he was doing
for technical things,
thank you, Lord,
said, Andy, I love your ministry, but your audio, you need to step up the quality of your audio visual game on your YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. And I was like, how do I do that? And he realized how ignorant I was.
He said, let me help you.
When you come back through here 6 months from now, I will set you up. And mm-hmm, he did. And
yes,
so it started there. Mm-hmm. That was one way practically. We mm-hmm have people who have offered us to stay at their house, and
yes,
they feed us when we go and minister mm-hmm on a regular basis. And we, as a result, we see them at least once a year, mm-hmm, and we just have wonderful fellowship. Mm-hmm. There's been people that, you know, we're just there one night, but they invite a bunch of friends over, and mm-hmm then we end up praying for people that get healed, yeah, and people get saved and mm-hmm give their lives mm-hmm to Jesus. Mm-hmm. That's been amazing. I remember other times where people, we're getting ready to go on an extended mission trip, and somebody bought our car and paid us what we were asking for with no haggling, just because they wanted to bless us with not having to go through the hassle mm-hmm of finding a buyer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's just numbers of different ways. One of the things that I really like to do is when I'm, you know, it can be such a powerful ministry tool when you're, you know, going out to eat, and you
to bless your server,
that's the general neutral one, I guess, with conversation, with interaction, mm-hmm, ask them how you can pray for them,
right, treat them like a person,
encouragement, and then finish the evening off with
a generous tip,
because Christians for some reason have gotten the reputation of being terrible tipplers, and I aim to crush that.
Right. That should not be the way it is, because again, that's not a reflection of our Father.
Exactly.
At all.
Mm-hmm. And some of that all gets rolled into one, giving a little bit more time, treating people with mm-hmm genuine kindness. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it takes that just to allow needs to surface, just in our interactions with mm-hmm people in the homeless community that we've been engaging with. I remember as we were walking around, you know, we found one lady that she was excited because she wanted prayer for an interview.
Sure, she was going to. Right.
But we also said, do you have clothes for the interview?
And
we were able to get her set up with mm-hmm some clothes for her interview. Different things like that. So, you know, there's so many things, but the neat thing about it is that in everything that we give, it's like an investment.
Absolutely.
Into eternity, because Jesus mm-hmm says, you know, if you even give a cup of cold water mm-hmm to the least of these, my brethren, you've done it to me.
Right. Yeah, it's really neat. It's not tick for tack. Like, it's not deposits and withdrawals like a bank account. It truly is more like, in the kingdom, is more like an investment.
Yep.
You put the money in and you get great rewards, great dividends back. And again, and sometimes those dividends and rewards are monetary, and sometimes they're other things, emotional and spiritual blessings.
Yeah. Amen. Mm-hmm. You know, ministry often is kind of an interesting thing. I remember one time when we were invited to minister at a location, and it was close enough to our house that we were driving over, but you know, it was several trips back, and you know, I went through probably a tank of gas going back and forth over mm-hmm the course of a weekend.
Mm-hmm.
And this particular ministry was in it was targeting a poor neighborhood, and mm-hmm there were lots of people that came. And I remember, you know, at the end of the weekend, he gave me the offering envelope, as you know, this was what was received during the weekend.
Right.
And I remember opening it up, and I saw
$5 bill. Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, you know, and in my heart right away, God said, so was this a waste of time?
Right.
Would you do this again? And I was like, Absolutely. I do it again. 100%. Yeah. God, I never did this for money. I did this for you. I don't look to them to provide or offerings to provide. Mm-hmm. And that was during a time where our, you know, our finances were getting a little bit low. And so I knew was I was believing God for finances again. And just saying, okay, God, I know you've got this. And you kind of look out on the horizon and say, well, I've got this scheduled and this scheduled and this scheduled. And so, you know, maybe God's going to lay it on somebody's heart to, you know, bless us in some special way. Well, what's funny is that every time I come up with a strategy for God, he sets it aside. And he just, what was neat though, was that was a Sunday evening that I was driving home. Monday, the very next day when I checked the mail, there was a large donation given to our ministry that was from a totally unexpected source. And it was just like God just saying, look, this whole weekend when, you know, you kept seeing the offering basket, you know, go start and return empty. And, you know, I wasn't paying attention, but I would just notice. I was like, I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. And then at the end, you're like, okay, that's it. You know, and I'm like, no big deal. That God had me well taken care of the entire time.
Before you even knew it was on its way.
But this comes into play not only in missions and ministry, but in business. There's a lot of times that we just play it safe. We like the leeks and onions of you know, working for a known quantity, for a known
or the
boss.
Steward that
we
just...
like the slavery that we do know instead of the challenge of breaking free, crossing a wilderness, and breaking into that place of freedom. And so it can be a real challenge, but I think the generosity is a key way to get there. But that generosity... it can't just be a tool of control and a formula where we learn a bunch of Bible verses that try to twist God's arm and put him in a headlock. Like, no, God, you have to. You've got to come to that place of absolute surrender and total. I am in the hands of God. He's all I want. I'm content. I am free from the love of money. And I'm going to go forward generously. And that keeps the kingdom activated for God to speak to you, to give you direction, to give you that creativity, to leave Egypt, to cross where you don't see anything, and it's just God providing water and quail and manna, and then to break through to that place of abundance where now you're in set up cities and stuff like that. That's just where it's always that way. It always starts with a vision of who God is, and it's got to rest on that.
Right. And we can always count on him to operate that way. Like I remember you're talking about the children of Israel, you know, when it came time to set up the tabernacle. I think we've talked about this before. You know, Moses said, whatever God lays on your heart, bring it.
Yeah.
And they kept bringing and bringing and bringing. And finally he had to say, whoa, stop. We can't even use all this.
Yeah.
And so again, that's an awesome picture of God's generosity of abundantly more than we could even ask or hope. And, and we can count on it because he moved on people's hearts.
Amen.
And that's how he likes to do it. There's a in that, you know, the little proverb too about the cheerful giver, you know, that really comes from the Holy Spirit. He's so happy to use us to give, and we just enjoy his presence with us in that, and enjoy the cheerfulness as well.
So I'm kind of laughing because I had just, what was it, yesterday? I can't remember. So Tina's been babysitting a kid for a single mom. He's 9 years old. He's become my fishing buddy. And he's been borrowing, you know, my extra pole this whole time. And I've had it on my heart to want to get him a pole. So I went to Walmart and I got him a really nice setup. You know, it was not cheap. It was probably $100 thing. But, you know, he was going to have to grow into it, you know, because it was a bait caster. But he had used some of mine and he had done okay.
Thought he was ready.
But you can tangle those pretty easy. So, yeah, we were about 30 minutes into our fishing mission trip, and you know, he's already backlashed it. So I said, well, would you like to use the old one that you've been using? He said, sure. So, you know, and he has this habit of back casting. He'd flop it into the water and throw it, and it's fine. I was like, just be careful. Well, sure enough, 15 minutes down the road, he leans his pole back to cast it, and in the backswing, he snags his new pole and he flings it forward, and it goes flying out of the boat and lands right in the river and just sinks right to the bottom. And little Jeffrey is his name, and he looked at me and he said, "Oh, Mr. Andy, I'm so sorry." I said, "Man, I'm sorry too."
Yeah.
And he looked at me and said, "I thought you were going to kill me." But, you know, sometimes that's what happens, is God gives us something amazing. We don't steward it well. But he's
not going to be angry.
And I said, "Jeffrey, we learned two lessons." I said, "What?" I said, "One's practical." I said, don't put your back cast in the boat. Your back cast needs to be to one side or the other. And two, it's not the end of the world.
Right. It's just a thing.
We don't put our happiness in those things. And I was happy to give that to you, but I'm sure that God's got other plans down the road. So, So brothers and sisters, you know, if you find yourself receiving a blessing from God and then it flings out of the boat, hey, we're excited because God is not limited.
No.
And I'm confident that God is going to take care of Jeffrey and take care of us. And so I hope your heart's hearing is encouraged, because this is encouraging just to talk about.
It is, honestly, just to remember his faithfulness.
Amen.
His goodness. Absolutely.
Well, brothers and sisters, thank you so much. Go and walk with Jesus. Impact your world. And we will see you next week. We release a new podcast every week, Friday at noon. And they're available through any major podcast app, as well as we upload studio videos on Facebook and YouTube. If you're not part of the Facebook group for the Sons and Daughters podcast, be sure that you do that so that we can carry on the good discussion with you. So meanwhile, God bless, take care, walk with Jesus, and impact your world.